My dudes, what is happening, man? This is Trent, and I'm back. It's Wednesday. It's time to do some drawing. And today I wanted to talk to you about freelancing. See, I was having this conversation with a friend of mine over at one of the... Well, she's actually working at one of the studios that is a client of mine. And we were talking about freelancing. We were talking about the challenges of freelancing. We're talking about the lifestyle of freelancing, because she's kind of looking at it and going, well, someday, yeah, I think maybe I want to do that sort of a thing. Now, I worked in-house at Capcom, I worked in-house at Blizzard, and then I worked in-house at Riot before I left and started my own art house, Aquatic Moon Studios. So on any given day, most of the time, I'm working on about 5 different games for different clients. So I know a little about this, and I wanted to kind of give a little bit of insight into what challenges you might face and some of the benefits as well. Let's start with the tough question, get that out of the way first. Are you ready to start doing contract, concept art, and illustration for video game companies? And to answer this, all you have to do is submit. So you put together your portfolio, and it's the best that you can do, and it's what you think concept art is based on your knowledge and experience of what you've seen online or from talking to other professionals. You developed your skill a little bit, and you sent off your best effort to a game developer, and you're hearing crickets. You're not hearing any response back, and you don't know why. Well, most likely you're not providing anything of useful value to that potential employer, and they're not reaching out back to you because you don't have game industry experience, you've never shipped any titles, or the kind of content that you're making just isn't what they need, or they're not looking for. They don't need a concept artist for their current project, or if maybe it's just not a fit. And you can't take that personally. I've talked about this a lot, and it's a lengthy discussion as to why your portfolio might be rejected. But if it is, then you're just not ready for that. Contract concept art jobs pour in when you're experienced enough and you're posting that kind of content on your art station. And when you make a submission, you always hear back. When you always hear back or almost always hear back, that means you're probably ready. But if you're not, then you're probably not ready. So that's the barometer. And if I do want to encourage you to consider, if you're not hearing back a lot, maybe try smaller studios, because you're just, maybe the skill level is not there yet, but you should be able to get jobs at smaller mobile game studios. Consider that, indie game studios, and it might be lower paying jobs and less prestigious, but then you're getting game industry experience and you're building your value. People always want to jump to level 10 right out of the gate. It's okay to be at level 2 and work your way up. Remember that. And I talked about that a lot recently in my How to Draw video series. The second thing I wanted to cover is, would you even enjoy it? Is it something that you would even want? Because some people really like to have people around. And when you're contract concept art, or you're doing contract artwork for a living, you're working from home. Now, there are advantages and disadvantages to that. The disadvantage is there's no water cooler talk. There's no, hey, what'd you watch on Game of Thrones last night? It's very, very little of this sort of a thing. Sometimes you're on a meeting with the client and you'll get a chance to chit chat about, you know, where you're from, or, you know, what shows you're watching or movies that you really enjoyed. But most of the time they're on the clock too, and you don't have time to dilly dally. So there isn't as much of that, like, hang out, play the game with your buddies, play the game that you're all working on, and share these, like, kind of developer moments. You don't get a lot of that sense of camaraderie. There are no holiday parties. Usually when you work at a game studio, they'll have a holiday party. There are no holidays off. Usually if you work at a game studio, you'll have, you know, holidays are nobody's working that day. When you're contract, sometimes you're planning to work, just because it's like, we work every damn day. And it might be, you know, President's Day or Martin Luther King Day. And it's like, oh, geez, the client didn't get back to me today. Oh, yeah, I forgot. It's totally a holiday. So there's a lot of other downsides. The other one is that sometimes they don't tell you what's wrong with your work, and there's no long term investment in you. So you might send in your artwork and they just tell you to keep going, you know, because you're not there. So they don't really have to give you feedback or guidance. And if they suddenly decide they don't like what you're doing, they don't have to renew their contract with you. They don't have to keep employing you. In fact, they could just stop sending you work. They have no obligation to you whatsoever. You have to pay for your own insurance, health insurance, which can be a bit of a bummer in the United States. It's a substantial amount of money, actually. There are no paid meals. Sometimes working at a game studio, they'll have like a snack box or something like that, or a shelf where you can just go and get free snacks. And you don't get that if you're a contract. You don't get anything like that. Also, if you're a contract, a lot of times you have to change your art style to whatever that client needs. And that's a very rapid progression. So 1 month you might be working on a kind of a fantasy cartoony thing. And the next month they expect you to paint very realistically, photorealistically. And you have to be able to change up that art style very quickly. If you're working on two contracts, sometimes in the same day, in the morning you might draw a cartoony thing. At night you're drawing a photorealistic, you know, military facility or something. That's not always the case. I mean, if you're a freelancer and you're known for doing a certain style of thing, you know, you might not need to do that. They might not ask you to do such a thing. I mean, I've experienced some pretty rough things with freelancing too. I've had clients erase my name out and then put their own artist name on my artwork. I've experienced clients who've told us we can't claim credit for the artwork that we did even after they posted it on their website, so we couldn't put it in our portfolio. I've had clients treat my personal work like as if it's client work for them, and they just take my character design ideas and then make it a character in their own game. I've had clients that have told us that they're going to pay us on a piece rate. And if you get paid on a piece rate, well, that can be advantageous if they're a really easy client to work with. But what that means is, like, no matter how many hours you spend on it, they just pay you this flat rate. And if they just keep asking you to make changes, that could end up costing you 40 hours of work for what you had, you know, budgeted only 10 hours of work to do. I don't take those kind of jobs anymore, but there was a time. I mean, I've experienced some crazy shit doing this kind of business. I've actually heard some of the craziest stuff. I actually had a client try to bill me to post the artwork we did for them in our portfolio. I was like, hey, we want to put some of this in our portfolio. He's like, yeah, we're going to have to bill you for that. I'm like, what? Yeah, we don't work with those guys anymore. You know, obviously. We'll just work with clients who treat us with some human respect. Thank you very much. Now, I think of myself as a pretty nice guy, but also mostly reasonable. And the thing is this kind of business really makes you grow a thick skin. You have to have a thick skin to do it. But when you're contract, you have to take care of your own finances. That means setting aside a percentage of your income for taxes, because nobody takes anything out for you. You also have to set up your own 401k plan and your own retirement plan, your own retirement accounting. There's a lot of personal responsibility that you carry running your own business, doing contract artwork for a living. When you're on contract, you can't just mosey on over to another developer's desk and say, hey, you got any ideas for this cool new costume or armor design I have to do? Nope, you're on your own. You cannot just mosey on around the office and ask for help. You also, usually if it's a top secret thing, you have to keep it very private. You can't go out and work on some things at a cafe, for instance, as much as you might think, because, you know, sometimes the client has a very specific privacy. They don't want the feature to be announced. If it's a known game, they don't want you working on, for instance, Overwatch character designs while you're at a cafe somewhere. That's not going to fly. You could end up in a lot of legal hot water if you do something like that. So you have to be protective of your client's privacy and your NDAs. You hardly ever get any direction or feedback in terms of, like, no art director is going to take the time to, like, paint over your stuff. Actually, there have been a couple of them. Some of my favorite art directors, Arnold Tsang on Overwatch, one of the best art directors I've ever worked with. This guy will actually remember the things that we worked on, that my team and I have worked on, and he'll actually draw over it to give us notes to help us improve it, to make sure that we're on point, so that we're learning, we're always improving. But that is super rare. It is very rare and uncommon for an art director to take the time out to give an outsourced contract artist feedback on his work. No stock options, no residuals. I have some artists that I know. I know some artists who worked on World of Warcraft 10 years ago, and they're still collecting, you know, earnings from their investment. You don't get any of that as a contractor unless if you negotiate very well for such a stock options. Contract negotiation and pricing your work. These can be real big barriers and issues for some people with certain personality types that are a little less assertive or aggressive. So negotiating contracts, sometimes, like, I had some experiences where I had to stick to my guns on some things, and I was fully willing to pass on this contract with a very prestigious client if they did not just give me what my reasonable hourly price rate was at that time. And I had to stick by my guns, and I took a huge risk, because if I didn't get that contract, I didn't know what I was going to do. But at the same time, I knew what my value was. So I stuck to my guns, and I was able to get a value that I felt was reasonable for the quality of work that I was doing and the speed that I was doing it at. I was a very experienced developer, so I knew what my value was. That's something that comes with time. You don't start out freelancing and know what your value is and then be assertive about that. You know, that comes from knowing what your value is. And you find out what your value is by working in-house or doing it for a long enough period of time. Getting clients can be challenging. Sometimes you go for, you know, 2 or 3 months without any jobs. And if you are not married to somebody with a stable job, that can be very stressful. Or if you don't have your parents, you know, paying your way, that can be very stressful to not know where the money's coming from. There is occasionally the difficult client that expects you to do 10 times as much work and half the time, or expects you to forget everything you've ever known and you have to do it their way, even if it's the wrong way. And that's fine. The client's always right. And that's a hard thing for some people to swallow. That's a hard pill for some people to swallow, because it's a pride thing. If you're a prideful person, it might not be the best career path for you. You don't want to be the contract artist who's always telling your client they're doing it wrong. Screw that. They're not going to want to work with you. So you have to have pretty decent people skills too, pretty decent communication skills if you want to do contract work. If not, it's not a bad thing to go and work for one of these art houses. And these things are really rising. They're popping up a lot lately. I've been running mine for about 6 or 7 years now. It's called Aquatic Moon, and I tend to do all of the client-facing stuff. So I do hire artists from time to time that have skills, but maybe they're still developing some aspects, like specifically on the communication side. So that can be really challenging for me at times when I have some artists will disappear or not give me what the client asked for, and I have to stay up late and make sure that the client's getting what they expect. And make sure that they're dealing with a person who understands their pipeline and their needs. So those are some of the challenges you might face doing it. If it seems glamorous, you might want to consider all the things that you sacrifice in order to be able to do it. Oh man, this is going to be a long video because I haven't even gotten to the best part. So I actually prefer contract work because, you know, it's my personality, but I like to manage my own schedule. One of the greatest advantages of doing contract work is that the harder you work, the more reward you get. That's not often true in-house. Sometimes you might be taking over somebody else's workload for a while at a studio and you're not getting paid anymore. You're not getting any more benefit. There's a maybe promise that you might get promoted, but that just means more work for you in the future too. As a contractor, it's like if you put in an extra 20 hours this week, you get paid for an extra 20 hours this week. It's a real awesome system of actual value for the time that you spend. Now, you sure you don't get to waste as much time. A lot of times at a game studio, you'll only work for 4 hours a day, and then you're in 3 hours of meetings, and then you get like an hour of playing the game every day, you know? But as a contractor, I could say, well, I'm going to get all of my work done before 5 p.m., and then I get to do whatever I want with the rest of my day. And I don't have a commute. I don't have to get in the car and drive for an hour in any direction each way. When I was working at in-house, my last job, I had to commute for an hour and a half each way. I only worked there for 3 or 4 months in-house because I was like, I can't do this commute. I started working from home a lot more, and they were actually really cool with that. It was a super chill company at the time. Now, as a contractor, I don't have to work with people that I don't want to work with. If we don't like each other, it's fine. They're not stuck with me. I'm not stuck with them. Contracting really suits me in that regard. I get to choose my clients. So if I have a boss who is particularly, you know, difficult with me or just doesn't like a lot of the ways that I do things, it's okay. As a contractor, we can finish out our obligation to each other and then part ways. And I tend to be very conservative and frugal financially. So it's no big thing for me to go for, you know, a short period of time without any income because I've planned for that. I'm a very self-reliant person and I have the personality qualities to be able to handle those downtimes. And what do I do during that time? I increase my value even more. And that's when you'll see me posting a lot more personal projects and things like that. And you'll see me really active in social media during those periods of time because that's when I'm finally free a little bit more to do so. And so it comes in waves and that just suits my personality because I'm a bit of an introvert in that way. A great example is today. It's a Monday right now when I'm recording this, and it's about 11:50 a.m. And I wouldn't be able to do something like this video series if I were working in-house. As a contractor, you're free to do personal things all the time. In fact, you could turn down clients. You could say, well, I've already booked something, a personal project for next month, so I'm not available during that period of time. So I have complete control over that. If you're working as an employee, you can't say, hey, I really want to take 2 months off to make this comic that I want to make. Mm-mm. No, they won't let you do that. Doing contract work, you can work out of any country. So my wife and I spent almost a month in Thailand a couple of years ago. We tend to travel to Hawaii a lot. I do enjoy the islands. And I'll sometimes just set up at a Starbucks on the beach and do my work while we're whale watching or something like that. I mean, that's kind of awesome. You don't necessarily get that as an employee at a game studio. You're free as a contractor to take your lunch hour whenever you can fit it into your schedule. So sometimes I'll just work straight through a day and then I'll basically take off from work a little bit earlier. I do try to segment out my space so that my workspace and my work time is fairly designated. And then my working on personal projects in the evenings is optional. It's not something that, like, basically during the day, you know, my wife and I have kind of a bit of an understanding. Hey, that's my work time. I got the do not disturb kind of a sign on my door. I don't literally, but she knows that this is my work time. And so it's designated so that I'm much more available in the evenings. Although I do take breaks throughout the day. I take about 15-minute breaks, 20-minute breaks to walk the dog. Once during the day and then once again in the evenings. I always make sure that I take that time, and I've been prioritizing fitness and exercise and diet a lot more in my life, and which I found is a little bit easier as a contractor. It's not as easy to do when you're working at a studio where they've got cake day and pizza day and all that stuff. And that might be awesome for you. You might be thinking, well, that's what I want. And honestly, working in-house is a great experience in your 20s and 30s. And I'll have to save my advantages of working for an employer in the games industry for another video, because that could, you know, drag this one out for another hour. One of my favorite things about working on contract is all of the people that I get to connect with. So I now have friends at Riot Games. I have friends at Sony Studios. So I go and visit their offices. I was just at the Blizzard office last week because we're doing some contract work with them and working on some projects together with different departments. And so, like, when I go to these campuses, I've been in this business for almost 20 years now. So I have friends all over the place, and it's so nice to be able to go to GDC, and every 20 steps, it's, you know, high fives and big hugs from old friends. And that's a really great experience, because if you're in-house, sometimes you don't get that ability to go to those events. They won't always let you go to those events, or there might be situations where you're focused on just the people that are in your immediate vicinity. There are some friends that I've lost touch with simply because they're very focused on just the people that are in their immediate vicinity, the people that they're currently working with. Another advantage is that you're never bored. I mean, last year we worked on Overwatch, we worked on League of Legends, we worked on probably five different games, from indie games like Cannonballers that just came out to, you know, prestigious games like Hearthstone. Like, we worked on all of those games in 1 year, and that's not something that you get as a in-house artist. You're just working on that one game for sometimes 3 or 4, 5 years. I worked on Diablo 3 for 5 years. There's no variety there. On any given day, we might be working on creature design or UI, icons, HUD interface, or mocking up character designs or coming up with skins or something like that. We never know. And I never know what to expect. When I wake up in the morning, I check my email box, and sometimes I got job offers from companies or games that I've been playing, which is pretty damn exciting. You don't get that as an employee. Politics. I don't have to deal with this stuff. I don't have to worry about somebody trying to protect their prestigious title at a game studio, or if they feel threatened by me. I'm an outsourcer. I'm a contractor. I can be eliminated tomorrow, and they're fine with that, and I'm fine with that. I'll just work with different clients. You know, a lot of times people don't realize how much politics are played in these big, big, huge game studios. And when I hear my friends talk about some of the things, the challenges that they have to face, I'm really not envious of that aspect of it, because I'm just a blunt guy. I'm very straightforward. If I have a strong opinion about something, I say it. And sure, I said I'm a nice guy, but I can rub people the wrong way, believe me, with my honest, direct opinion. And I've softened that a little bit. I try to be considerate. I try to think of things from other people's perspective and try to treat them with the appropriate respect for their role. But that doesn't always fly too well in a big corporate environment where they just need you to do the thing that they hired you to do, you know? There's no ceiling with contract work. If I make a product and it sells extremely well, if it's a business venture of my own, there's no ceiling. There's nobody to like make sure that I only get paid X amount of dollars. Now, that's a trade-off because I also don't have a minimum that I'm guaranteed to make either. But as an employee, if you're, say, a senior, you can't make more than other seniors. That's just their system of rules, their ceilings. There is none of that in contract. The harder I work, the more I make. And that also leads to the instability of doing contract work, which is the biggest challenge that most people have to face. But I will say that it's gotten more consistent as time goes on. At any given time, we're working on 2 to 3 different games. And that's considered small. We never really have more than 5 artists working with Aquatic Moon at any given time. And I just found that's about how much I can handle, manage, you know, reasonably well. After 7 years, we pretty much have job offers all the time now. So we kind of get to pick and choose, but we had to build up that reputation. You know, years ago, I read an article, I think it was Tony Robbins that said that your level of happiness in life is directly proportionate to your comfortability with the uncertain. So what that means is like the more comfortable you are with not knowing what's going to happen next, the more fulfilling your life and existence will be. Now, that's not true for everybody, but that resonated with me. And it's why I decided no matter what it takes, I'm just going to stay contract. I just enjoy it too much. It suits me way too much. This video could easily be several hours long, but what do you guys think? Do you see yourself as more of somebody who likes the structure and consistency of being an employee at a game studio? Or do you see yourself more as somebody who would want the freedom of being an independent contractor with all the self-reliance and all the responsibility that comes with that? Leave your questions and comments in the comment section below the video. And dudes, if you like my artwork that I've had going in the background here, I've got all kinds of tutorials and brushes available over on my Gumroad channel. Also, you can read some of my comics and novels over on my Amazon shop now that that's up. So don't forget to subscribe. And dudes, I'll catch y'all on my Yondabon. So ciao, baby. Oh, yeah. I get fired for that one.